I dream. I knew when we collided, you're the one I Psalms. Would you stand as this family is seated? As we begin our memorial, I want to say a hearty welcome to all of you to Bethany Christian Church, but also a thank you for all that you've done in your compassion and your care for this family. There's things that nobody else knows about, but only you and they, when it comes to your contacts by phone or whether you made face-to-face visits with them. Perhaps you took some food by to the family. I know that the food that was provided by the church today, we thank the church and for the hospitality that the church provided, as well as all the work that went into it. Christy worked with the family, and the family working with Christy, planning this memorial service. The beautiful leaflet the family has provided for you. Hope that you got one as you came in, because it has a full obituary inside. And it's something that will be not only something you'll keep for a long while, but something that you'll want to use as a tool. It'll become a tool. Remembering is our way of doing the work of grief. And so this will become a tool for you to be able to remember the family by. And you'll put this in a prominent place, whether it's in your truck or in your coat pocket or on your desk at work or on your refrigerator. Somewhere where you'll see it, so that when you see her picture and you think about this family, you'll pray for them and you'll ask for God to do what only He can do in bringing healing. Remembering is His task that He's given us to do it. It is a task. That's why we have memorial services. That's the beginning of our task, or a good portion of our task anyway, in meeting together. Them greeting you was a beautiful thing, as they greeted you at the back as you came in. And at the end of the service, at the conclusion, since there will be no burial, you will have an opportunity to be dismissed and to come down and to greet the family and spend a little time letting them know how much you love them and how much you will continue to remember them in prayer, and perhaps you'll also give them some memories. I would warn you about one thing, and that is, if you are a person who is experienced with grief, you already know how busy a day it has been for this family. Even though they have eaten and they spent time with you and they enjoy that time with you, it's still a very task-oriented day. It's a difficult day. You only know that if you've experienced grief yourself. And if you haven't experienced it, you're not aware of it. And so in your time and spending it with the family, don't take this as the time to tell them a 30-minute story today, because we really don't have time for 30 people to tell them a 30-minute story apiece. And believe me, I do enough memorial services, people try to do that. So don't try to do that today. What you might do is you'll think about getting a card and writing that story in the card and sending it to the family. It'll actually do three things. Number one is it'll give them that memory that perhaps they don't have. They haven't shared that before. They'll have it, and they'll be able to return to it later on. Not just told one time, but rather something they can go back and read again and reread and share with each other. And then third is that there is family that didn't have a chance to be here today, and friends. And when those friends and family travel and come to be with them, they'll be able to take those cards out and let that to be fodder for conversation, to be able to share memories and for them to continue that grief journey. Is it necessary for them to continue that grief journey? Yes. That is part of the journey. And the journey is one that really is precious. And your being here today is a big part of that. And so if you registered as you came in, thank you for that. If you didn't register, we're not going to get your name and come visit you to become a member of our church. That register is for them. And so if you registered or you're afraid to, don't be afraid. Go ahead and write your name down, because the family will take it and it'll be for them. All right. Now, if you're interested in our church, you can talk to me. And I'll be glad to talk to you and be a part of our church. But we're not going to take names and come see you. So don't think that we've got some secret police back there taking your names on a busy evening. For all that you've done, I want to say a hearty thank you. That means a great deal for this family. The family, in turn, has given you not only the leaflet, but also the pictures that you're going to be viewing on the slides. I'm an old enough preacher that I still remember when I was the only one that got to see those pictures. And that was because I went over to the family's house to visit and get ready for the service, and they took out the family albums and showed me the pictures. And that was the way we did it back then. But now they're able to show you the pictures as they're going to be showing you here in just a little while, as they did earlier before the service began. That's a gift from the family, and that'll be something that you will want to thank the family for when you have opportunity at the end of this service. Thank you again for all that you've done. Keep them in prayer and remembering them. I'm going to read a psalm that I'm going to lead us in a rendition of the Lord's Prayer. Psalm 116. I love the Lord, for he heard my voice. He heard my cry for mercy. Because he turned his ear to me, I will call on him as long as I live. The cords of death entangled me. The anguish of the grave came upon me. I was overcome by trouble and sorrow. And then I called on the name of the Lord. O Lord, save me. The Lord is gracious and righteous. Our God is full of compassion. The Lord protects the simple-hearted. When I was in great need, he saved me. Be at rest once more, O my soul, for the Lord has been good to you. For you, O Lord, have delivered me and my soul from death, my eyes from tears, my feet from stumbling, that I may walk before the Lord in the land of the living. I believed, therefore I said, I am greatly afflicted. And in my dismay I said, all men are liars. How can I repay the Lord for all of his goodness to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all of his people. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. O Lord, truly I am your servant. I am your servant, the son of your maidservant. You have freed me from my chains. I will sacrifice a thank offering to you and call on the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all of his people, in the courts of the house of the Lord, in your midst, O Jerusalem. Praise the Lord. Let's pray together. Father, we do love you, and even as we pray here in a moment that Lord's Prayer, I pray, hear our prayer as a joint prayer of compassion and a joint prayer of earnest plea for you to help us in our need. Join me now as we recite the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I'm always grateful when at a memorial service there is family that wants to come and share. We have several that are going to come and share. I know that Patrick is going to read a portion, and then I know also Emily and Darrell are going to be coming and sharing, and there may be some others. Is that right? We're going to be sharing as well. You all come up in that order, and then if you have some additional ones that want to come up, y'all come on. Come right up here. Is this where you'd like to come? There is a microphone here that you can speak to as well. Come around this side of the flowers. You might have this access.
This message is from Brandon. Law was a great person and helped give us a great childhood, and they loved doing crafts and going to Dollar Tree. That was their thing. Okay, and this is written by Emily. We all have that one individual we see for the first time, whether it be on TV or at the grocery store, and automatically idolize them. Those bright colors and the white as snow smiles hypnotize you, and suddenly all the dreaded fears of the world are gone. Then you turn off the TV and everything is back. No more golden beams radiating off people, and all of a sudden the world is holding you down again. But for me, my TV never turned off. With Debbie, or who we call Law, or Lala, our lights were forever on. With her, it felt like our world was eternally bright. Whatever room she was in, the happier people were. Once her angelic light reached you, you never felt alone and never felt useless. She was the best friend that everyone wishes they had. She was one of the most thoughtful people I've ever met. I vividly remember waking up every Sunday morning to her light blue walls and the smell of orange Danish rolls and my favorite show playing in the background. Then she would immediately hug me, kiss me on the top of my head, and whisper, "Good morning, sweet girl." I always felt so loved just being in her presence. I never saw her bad side. She was never angry. She always worked with us to find a solution that we both liked. Every time I went to her house, she had a new craft for us to do. She would sit at our tiny little blue table that was made for kids and just watch in amazement. Then she would hold her hands and we would walk to the hallway to find a spot to hang our new projects. I can distinctly remember her standing there, staring in admiration with her hands calmly laying on her chest, forming a cross. She just was consistently proud of us, whether we drew a squiggle or whether we recreated what was Van Gogh's masterpiece. She never doubted us. I am thankful that I've had someone like her in my life. She was always up for activities no matter what. She never once sat down. Never. She always kept pushing through and worked as hard as she possibly could. And this is from Kevin and I. We thought Papa's funeral was going to be hard, the hardest thing that we've ever done. And we were wrong. The passing of your mother is far one of the most difficult things in life to face. Love was the glue that kept our family all together, especially after Papa died. If you hear it, you know what a loss this truly is. She meant so much to so many people. She worked hard at full tilt 24/7. Whether it was work or play, Law had the energy and life to do it all. If you had something great to say, she made you feel amazing and wonderful about it. If you were having a hard time, she'd listen and offer sound advice, which undoubtedly was almost always right. I'm thankful that she made so many great and wonderful memories for all of us, but too, especially with the grandchildren. Who else can make painting flowers? Planting flowers and picking weeds fun. Lockwood. All jokes aside, I just want to thank her for all of the years of love and devotion she gave us. I'm thankful and know that the world is truly losing an angel. She will be greatly missed. I can't put into words how hard it will be to recover from this. I keep trying to text her on her phone and call her for comfort. But know she's okay, and she's with Papa, Nanny, Wildflower, Roxy, and Bruiser, many others. We will recover and life will go on. We were so blessed to be a part of her life and be loved by her.
Gonna be honest, I decided last minute that I wanted to say something, and I'm gonna make it a point not to stare at the family like this, but they know. I don't know, y'all know Thomas? It's Thomas. Thomas, say hi to people. Thomas, there you go. It's my sidekick. I wanted to say, you know, what Debbie meant to me personally. I've known the family for, unfortunately, 25 years now. One thing I just wanted to say is that, you know, when I first met Patrick and Daniel and Kevin and Thomas, I was 14, 15 years old, and I didn't grow up in the best household. And going to my friend's house was my outlet. And she accepted me as one of her own. And I know it couldn't have been easy, you know, she was already raising three big boys, they eat a lot. And what's one more, right? But she did. Her and Danny really accepted me and took me in as one of their own. And I'm so grateful for that. And I just wanted to say how much she meant to me. And thank you, Daniel, Kevin, Daniel. I really do love you guys. And thank you for making me a part of your family. Thank you.
everybody. My name is Thomas, and I was fortunate enough to know Debbie since I was 13 years old. She was always so sweet, so kind, so loving. There were so many times in the household where, you know, I would come over and spend the weekend with Pat, and there were so many times where, you know, things were said. And looking back now, as a parent now, looking back, it was like, man, she always knew the right things to say. You know? Because as teenage boys, we tend to run our mouths. And
no.
She always knew. She always knew how to defuse the situation. Like it was said earlier, you know, we never saw a bad side. She was always so loving. And I can still hear her voice being the calm in the storm when it seemed like everything else was chaotic around us. I'm so grateful to have known her, to be able to have spend time with her. Even though I was a kid, you know, she got to watch us all grow up. And I'm just very grateful for her. She was definitely my mom when I was away from my mom.
I want to say thank you to all of you. You all did some beautiful jobs in presenting greetings. Her, thank you for that. Thank you for special memories for this family.
With how busy my mom was, always was with taking care of us and working a lot. And we spent a lot of time at High Sky just as children. And I just want to thank everybody from up there because y'all were always so nice. And, I think the biggest thing is I asked Riley, my son, you know, what his favorite thing about Lala was. And he said it's going to get sushi with her from at HEB. And it doesn't sound like much, but she knew how to pick that one thing that makes you feel so special and make you feel like you're the only person on earth. And I'm so thankful that she was my mom. She is my mom. Don't worry, it wasn't all sunshine and rainbows. If you made her mad, it was not pretty. Believe me, I've done it a few times. So she definitely had that side of don't mess with her kids. She's the nicest person until you mess with one of us, and then it's... I'm selfishly, I'm sad because she's gone. I mean, I literally was my best friend. Like, I saw her every day. I text her every day. She watched Riley when I was at work. And it just doesn't feel real. It just doesn't feel real because she's not here. But there's a part of me that is so glad that she is with George now. That's the part that gives me comfort. And thank you.
Thank you, sir. Very heartfelt. No, I'm not saying it's not the end.
Okay.
I was just fixing to say again, it's in the end. Let's just
okay.
Keep going here. Don't want to preclude anybody, but all the time in the world.
Hello, friends. I'll just start off with saying, I made Law master her bedside. So y'all might not have seen it, but I've seen the hypothesis, the scientific theory, the rough draft, and the final copy through many forms of my life. So first I'm gonna read something from Donna, and this was Law's best friend for like last 6 years, and of course a family friend as well. I've known Debbie for 7 years. She's been my best friend for the last 6. Debbie was the most kindest, most kind-hearted woman I've ever known, and I'm really known to miss her a lot. Several times this week, I have seen or heard something interesting and thought, I have to tell Debbie about that. And then I remember she's gone. Her absence leaves a hole in my heart, in my life, but the memories of her will always be a blessing to me. I hope that's true for all that I've known her. For all that I've known her, yes, that is very true. So thank you, Donna. All right, I'll try to get through my speech, and then I have, I'm gonna close with the words from her sister. So my speech, I got a couple stories I wanna tell. And first one is, this is a 100% true. I'm not making this story up at all. But in one 30-minute window in my life, she taught me how to backpedal faster than Deion Sanders and believe in UFOs all at the same time. And I'm talking about like backpedal like Deion Sanders, like transfer your hips, don't get your shoulders over your feet, make sure you maintain balance. And I was an offensive lineman, so I'm trying to break down Deion Sanders here. But our parents were divorced when, you know, from a very young age, like that's what I remember. I ran my mouth faster than Usain Bolt could run. And there are no more fearful words than, all right, Patrick, I'm taking it to your father's house. So right then and there, I learned how to backpedal faster than Deion Sanders, because all of a sudden I could mow the lawn, paint the house, do the taxes, all in one fell swoop to get out of that statement right there. And then, this is when my belief in UFOs came in. On the ride over there, and it was a short ride in Midland, we're talking A Street down to Wall Street, right by Midland High, not far at all. I knew the good Lord at that time, but I knew he was not saving me from the reckoning that was coming. So I would look out the window and be like, please, Lord, send a UFO to beam me away right now, because that's the only thing stopping me from what's coming to me. So that's a lesson I learned. Another one is, and this story happened about 8-9 years ago, and up until, I would say, you know, she passed Monday, Friday or Saturday, the last time we talked, this is kind of how we closed our conversations was, it's going great. Those were our 3 words. So this story happened when Lala and Papa were together. Wednesday night, they would keep Emily and Braden. And I would try my hardest if I wasn't working or closing to go over there. We could get Bob's Better Burger. That was our jam. That's what we liked. That night, Emily and Braden had some hand puppets. And of course, there was a VIP show. Only 3 tickets were allowed. You know, it was me, Lala, and Papa. And they're putting on the show, using the puppets, just having the absolute greatest time. And Brayden looked over at us with complete joy, happiness, like in his mind, he envisioned how the puppet show was gonna go. He just looked at us and said, it's going great. And so for the last 8 years, no matter what the situation was, no matter what was happening in life, no matter what your emotion was, we could just look at each other, smile, even if we didn't want to smile, and just know it's going great. So it's going great. Through the ups and downs, great, Emily, it's going great. The second one is, or this, I'll close with this for my part. This past Ash Wednesday, I actually had a chance for the first time. Don't get me wrong, I had many chances to go, but this is the first time I went to the Ash Wednesday service. And the day I went, it was one of those days to where you wake up and you're already stressing the day. You're already rushing yourself for no reason. And you read every email that says, hello, Patrick is Patrick. It's just one of those days you're just frustrated throughout the day. Service started, I think, at like 6:30 or 7. By like 5 o'clock, I realized I had to go. And like I was still kind of like, oh man, like I was stressing. So I kind of just, you know, pray for calmness. I just want to be open-minded. I do know I can show up to the Lord in any condition, but I want to be open-minded and kind of relaxed for Him. I walked in there and sat down, and it was the absolute coolest feeling I've ever had. Just the calmness came over me, and the message that I got from that service, and which resonates with me today, is we're not alone. And no matter what, we might feel isolated, we might think about it, it might be 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock in the morning, and we feel alone, but we're really not. For a long time, I didn't really understand God's plan. I argued it, battled it, cussed it, whatever you want. But God's plan is in this room today. We are God's plan. I know for a fact God put Thomas and Daryl in my life, along with Chris back here as well. I've been fortunate to have three best friends for 20 plus years. They're family. But me and Thomas played football at San Jacinto in 7th and 8th grade. 7th grade. Daryl was the quarterback for Goddard. Unbeknownst to us at the time, Thomas's mom actually recorded one of our games that we played Goddard. So the point was to obviously record Thomas. Of course, in that film, you can hear Daryl calling out the quarterback. Saying, you know, blue 42, all those different things. Of course, you can hear that. The quarterback is supposed to say that. But over the whole entire game video, you can hear Daryl's mother from the opposite sideline going, go, Daryl! Go, Daryl! So, to this day, we still say, go, Daryl! So, God's plan was plain and simple. He put people in our lives, He put law in our lives to get us this point so we can carry not only her further, but ourselves further. So, God's plan is great. I understand it. I love it. And it's been a big part of my life. Now I'm trying to be strong every Susie's part. This is her sister. Little backstory from them. Jimmy's here. Jason, their son's not here. But my fondest memories of this is back when TGIF was on what ABC or whatever show it was, and it was Full House, Family Matters, I think Perfect Strangers, and something else. We would get pizza, Pepsi or Coke. I think Kevin liked Pepsi, didn't like Coke, so we always had Pepsi. I could be wrong there, but we always watched that at their house on Friday nights. So this is from her Aunt Susie. Her sister, yeah, I'm sorry. Sorry, I messed my words up, Sarah. My apologies. That's my accountability partner. All right. To my precious sister, it has been an honor and a privilege to transverse this life with you. You were and are a blessing, not only in my life, but to so many others. Your enduring legacy is a life of love and service. Job well done. My precious sister, job well done. Until I see you again, I will leave you with this prayer. May the road rise up to meet you. May the wind always be at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face and the rains fall soft upon your fields. Until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of his hands. And the next song that is coming up is actually from the choir that she sings in Houston, and it's a song they sang. So, thank you.
Oh.
remarks for you about your mother and about those that you love. This wonderful Lala, we're precious. Thank you for all those remarks. And I'm glad that y'all are recording this, that you're able to go back and hear it again, watch it again, and be able to look at those remarks specifically. Finally, it has honored me a great deal in giving you the opportunity of also bringing in some words about her life, as well as a piece of poetry and a prayer. Debbie Henshaw Bogle. She was born into this world July 20th, 1954 in Midland, Texas to T.D. Windham and Anita Foltz and Big Sister Susan, the obituary writes. Of course, she died on Monday, March 21st. She was a dedicated and compassionate woman, as you can tell from the remarks of family as well as good friends. Hardworking, sacrificing, had a good sense of humor. She was thick-skinned. That came after the birth of the children. Kill them with kindness. That's one of her phrases. Teaching her kids. Kill them with kindness. She was a people watcher. Loved watching people and loved loving people. She loved her life, and she did have her hands full raising those three wonderful sons, Kevin, Patrick, and Daniel. Took all three of them to New York three times. That took a great deal of courage to take three kids to New York City. That is not an easy thing to do. David slept in the oven. Now let me explain that. They were in a small motel together, and he slept on the chair, and he put his feet over by pulling the oven door down. And it looked like he was cooking. Got to see a lot of things and do a lot of things. Went to Manti's restaurant, a favorite restaurant of the families there in New York. Also, they remembered several trips, and one of those trips involved going to Tennessee to the National Zoo. I know Patrick enjoyed that very, very much. She met and married the love of her life, George Bolin. He was her man. Always ask people about who they think was a hunk. What did your mother think was a hunk? It was him. It was the hunk. They married in Fort Davis, Texas. Butterfield Inn, cabin number 4. I'll look that up when I go there. I see it. She loved taking the kids there as well. Lala and Papa. I like the way you phrase that together. Lala and Papa together. She loved spending time with her grandchildren, Emily and Brayden and Riley, and her sweet dog pups. She also enjoyed painting and cleaning, painting flowers and pulling weeds. If you have three boys, you have to learn to like to clean. She loved taking them to the park, and she was a responsible person with the grandkids. Never anybody ever make that remark to me before how responsible she was, because she did what they said. And many grandparents will simply listen to what you say in instructions, and they just do what they want to anyway. She did what they said. She took responsibility in taking care of those kids. She enjoyed 40 plus years at High Sky Children's Ranch, and she made a lot of memories and lifelong friends there. That is a long time to be in service in a place where serving children and serving adults who were doing their best to try to get their children back. She worked closely with board members and the Crystal Ball Committee to ensure that the Crystal Ball was always run flawlessly. Annually. Preceded to death by her husband, George Bogle, Danny Henshaw, and parents T.D. Windham and Anita Folt. Of course, she is survived by son Kevin Henshaw and wife Katie, children Emily and Braden, son Patrick Henshaw and wife Sarah, and their fur babies, Clyde and Duchess. You haven't met them yet, you have something to look forward to. And son Daniel Henshaw and children Riley and Kate Breen. She loved the color turquoise. And she loved the art of Georgia O'Keeffe. Southwest art she liked. She loved places that had actual seasons to them. Odessa was not one of those. Boston and Chicago and those places where you actually get to see the seasons change. She loved Christmas time, and she loved crafting and painting and picture collecting. All kinds of Southwest colors. Nothing dull or plain. She liked the colorful. She loved crime dramas. Lifetime. She liked soft rock, Daniel Archuleta. She liked watching American Idol. She was creative with food. Again, something you have to be with three boys. There's only so many things you can do with hot dogs. Be creative. She'd go, no garlic, and everything had to be well done. As a matter of fact, there was a time that they were eating some hamburgers from somewhere else, and she noticed they were not done enough. She pulled them out of their hands and put them into the microwave, and she nuked them hard. Then gave them back to eat. She loved local Mexican food fare. That was an important thing, that she loved the place where she was because this is where her family was. A piece of prose that's one of my favorite when it comes to a woman like her. Lord, I beg you, give me a mission, some great work to do for thee. Lead me to some noble task that men may find thy love in me. And even as I prayed, my children crowded round my bended knee. Why, I wonder, does the Father overlook my urgent plea? Surely he desires our efforts, poor and humble though they be. Could it be that in his great wisdom he had already answered me? In my long and fevered searching, I had been too blind to see what the Father, wise and loving in his plans, would have me be. Faithful wife, gentle mother, molding lives, my destiny. And it was her. It's not just for her children, but for many, 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 many other children as well. Let's pray. God, we love you. We thank you for the life of a wonderful woman. Thank you for all that she has been, not only to this family, but to the many people who've worked with her and the many people who know her. We pray earnestly that as we continue in listening to music and reading scripture, that we honor her today, Lord, and it being her day in the kingdom of heaven. We love you. Help us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. gorgeous music. Thank you for picking those gorgeous pieces of music. I want to read one last passage of scripture, rather brief, and make some very brief comments about it. Read one last piece of prose, and then we're going to sing a song together before you get turned to come up and visit with the family. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, known as that chapter of love. If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels but have not love, I'm only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains but have not love, I'm nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and surrender my body to the flames but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient, love is kind, it does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud. It is not rude, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered, it keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, trusts, hopes, and perseveres. Love never fails. Where there are prophecies, they will cease. And where there are tongues, they'll be stilled. And where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we only know in part, and we prophesy in part. When perfection comes, the imperfect disappears. When I was a child, I talked, thought, and reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put childish ways behind me. Now we see but a poor reflection, as in a mirror. But then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. That passage of scripture is classic in telling us about love, reminding us of all those aspects of love. And if you research it and look through it and spend a lot of time with it, it can instruct you over and over again. Classically describing the beautiful lady that we've been remembering today. But there's a great deal more there too. It tells us there are some things that pass away. Our bodies will change. Thank God for that. As you get old, you'll learn that. Thank God. But our bodies will change. And our bodies will be transported and made different. This passage of scripture says there's some significant things that are going to cease. Number one, you'll rejoice with me about. One day, prophecy will cease. No more preaching. That's a good thing. You ready for it? I am. I do at least two memorial services a week. The day will come when I'll be out of a job. How grateful I will be. No more memorial services. Though memorial services are significant, I know some people who don't attend. And I know some people who do not any longer follow protocol at funerals, and it disturbs me. Some of you who are older as I am, you may be disturbed at the new generation's lack of manners. There's no longer any manners. No one abides by manners anymore. I remember when I was in the sixth grade, we spent a week learning how to eat at a table. My sixth grade teacher took the cafeteria, took us to it, and he learned to set the table, and we learned manners at the table. No one learns that. And today in funerals, I find people who will, for example, when there is a body, there's no body here today, but when there is a body, many people, I don't do that. I don't go by and look at bodies. How rude. How rude for the family to have prepared a body and to have brought that body. This is all about remembering them, and they refuse to come by and look at the body. That's rude. You may not know it, but the family is insulted. You didn't come and help the family. Why don't you just stay home? You say, that's rude. It sure is. In its own way, but you really ought to. You should abide by it. Funerals really are the closest thing we get to the resurrection. That's why we do it. Because there will be a day when we'll all be gathered once again in the kingdom. And really, this is the only place that we do it anymore. In gathering together. Because people don't go to church. And I heard the rudest remark I've ever heard about weddings the other day. Someone said, hey, you're going to come to my wedding? I said, I'll catch your next one. Pretty rude. is a reason why we gather together. And we gather together to remember, and that remembering is an important thing. Prophecy will one day cease, and that will be a good thing. You agree with me. You said, yeah, I'm agreeing with you even more today. Listen to you now. I'll be glad when it's all done. It'll be done one day. There'll also be no longer tongues. They'll be stilled. You said, we're not going to talk in heaven. No, and I thank God for that. Because I'm a counselor. Thank God. Nobody's going to be just talking my ear off anymore. Because we'll be able to communicate in ways that we can't communicate here. And you'll be understood. I'm a public speaker, and I'm constantly misunderstood. My father told me that because we are all old field workers in my family. And when I became a minister, he said, oh, boy, Jimmy, you stick your foot in your mouth all the time anyway. You might as well be a preacher. But it's going to happen all the time. Sure enough, it does. People misunderstand and misread and misinterpret what I've said. It just happens if you're a public speaker. Thank God one of these days it will no longer be necessary. Then we'll be able to communicate fully even without words. You say, that sounds almost Star Trek-y. Well, it is. We will not have to use words. He says, knowledge will vanish away also. No more how-to manuals. Of course, men don't read them anyway, do they? No more how-to manuals. We won't have to read them anymore. Knowledge will vanish away. Instead, we'll already know. There'll be no learning. Didn't say we won't be experiencing things. There will be things to experience. Heaven will be glorious. But he says, these things remain, and I'm fixing to finish. Faith, we will remember the past. And I'm grateful for that. Someone told me one day, they said, you know, Jimmy, in heaven, Jesus will have forgotten all about your sins. No, it doesn't say that. He says, they'll be not remembered against me. You see, I can't imagine walking in heaven and seeing Jesus and Jim and Jesus going, what's your name? Who are you? No, he'll say, Jimmy, I know it all. Now go to the corner where I will stand for 1,000 years, I'm sure. No, he will know. He'll already know. And there will be a remembering of the past, but a forgiving. They'll be hoping, looking for a future and an eternal bliss, a kingdom of eternity. Things will be different. And there'll be loving. And that loving for you and I is right in the present right now. Loving and continuing to serve, continuing to abide in him until those three things become eternal. In heaven, faith will be a completely new value. Today, some of you are even thinking about what you're going to do this afternoon right now. That's okay. We all do it. Our valuing will be different in the kingdom. Today, here and now, as a minister and as a counselor, and many of you I know may have worked at the same place you did, so you are counselors also. People don't value relationships. Those things aren't valued very much anymore. Instead, they value other things. Some things about the relationship, more often they will value you as long as they can use you for something. As long as you're profitable. McDonald's says they do it all for you. They do, don't they? No, they don't. They do it all for profit. As much as you like McDonald's, I'm glad you do, but they do it all for profit. And so does the world. There we will value differently. Relationships will be valued. Relationships that were past, they will be renewed again, and that will be so very important. Don't you? Are you like me? I don't care if I get a mansion. I don't care if I get a shack when I get to heaven. And I don't care really what there is going to be to do as long as the people are there. If the people are there who've gone on before, I'm going to be fine. Because they'll be there. We'll be joined together. Hope will be a great purpose, a great why for it all. And I have a lot of whys. Why? Understand. Learning to finally get it, and that is that it is the journey, and there's supposed to be a lot of whys in our mind. Why is it this way? Why did that happen? Love, this isn't original. Love will be emerging. Right now, every once in a while, in my work with families, both as a hospice chaplain and also as a minister doing funerals, I find some people who almost merged. the man and wife were so close that in the loss of that neighbor, in the loss of a child, or in the loss of a great friend, they were such companions and they were so close that they almost merged with each other. But it's only almost. In the kingdom, it will be commonplace. You and I will be able to merge with each other. Completely understand each other. Know everything about each other. Completely love each other. For all that we are and all that we hope. Not long ago, God called you home. My loss was heaven's gain. Though gone from my sight, the fingerprints you left me still remain. The void you left no one can fill. Your loss, too much to bear. But oh, what comfort now to find that your prints are everywhere. They show up unexpectedly in moments and in places, in sights and sounds and scents, and even in faces of those you touched with your warm heart and all your loving ways. Those marks you left no flood can wash, and nor can time fade away. Let's pray. Father, thank you for a person who's left fingerprints. And even though she is in the kingdom with you eternally, in that place that's glorified by you, we pray you give us opportunity to be able to share, remembering, seeing those fingerprints in the variety of places where they are. Lord, thank you for Debbie. Thank you for her life, thank you for her family, thank you for her friendships, and thank you for her eternal life that you have given her as a gift so that we may all enjoy each other eternally. We love you, how great you are. Would you stand together? Hymn number 33, there's a hymnal in front of you and the words may be up here, are they up here? Hymn number 33, How Great Thou Art, the song the families ask us to sing.
If there's a fourth person, I'm not sure.
There is.
And Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow with humble adoration and then proclaim my God and great God.
Say a prayer, and after our prayer, family will remain up here toward the front, but they will stand so that you can get to them and give them a hug. You come up afterwards and greet them at your leisure. Lord Jesus, we do love you so very much. We pray earnestly your blessing upon this family and help. You are a great God. You have done so much for us, not only in this world in giving us survival skills, but then also, Lord, in the promise of eternal kingdom coming that now Debbie is enjoying. Bless us as we leave this place and help us as we fellowship with one another in Jesus' name. Amen. You are dismissed. Thank you for being here.
Thank you. Thank you so much.